Blackstone Audio presents The Unraveling of Violeta Bell, a Morgue Mama Mystery by C.R. Corwin. To Sandy LeMasters for that D in high school journalism and all the other help along the way. I've never been one of those blame-the-victim types. If a woman gets flashed in the parking lot at the mall, it's not her fault because she has the audacity to have female parts. It's the flasher's fault for giving in to his creepiness. But I've got to agree with Ike on this one. Violeta Bell's own foolishness most definitely increased the odds she'd come to a bad end. Dolly Madison Sprowls, head librarian, the Hannawa Herald-Union. Chapter 1. Monday, June 19. I learned long ago not to give my story ideas to the editors. They grin at you like a constipated duck. They quack, "Ooh, what a great idea!" Then they never assign anyone to write it. And if by some miracle they do, the reporter gets the story wrong. So I stay in the morgue and do my job and hope the editors stay in the newsroom and try like the dickens to do theirs. But there I was, scooting toward Nancy Peel's desk just as fast as my full mug of Darjeeling tea would let me go. But good gravy, I couldn't help myself. The idea was just too good. Nancy has been the features editor since the Jurassic Age, which means she's been at the Hannawa Herald-Union almost as long as me. So we've had our share of run-ins. "Sorry to bother you, Nancy," I said with as much cheeriness as I could muster on a Monday morning, "but I just had to pass along something I saw." She looked up from her pecan roll, gave me that duck look. "You know we're always looking for good stories, Maddy." I bolstered myself with a long sip of tea and began. "Well, I was on my way to get some milk bones for James and a few groceries, and you know what Saturdays in June are like. More garage sales than dandelions. Anyway, I was on Pershing, just a couple blocks south of West Apple, and a taxi had pulled up in front of this house with a garage sale sign and a driveway full of junk, and these four old women were getting out, dressed in the most god-awful outfits, like circus clowns on their way to church." I took another sip, peeking over the top of my mug to make sure Nancy was still listening. "Anyway, it occurred to me that maybe they hired a cab every Saturday to drag them from one garage sale to another, and wouldn't that make a great story if they did?" Nancy's mouth was now full of pecan goo.
"And do they?"
I was ready for her. "Every Saturday all summer for the past 4 or 5 years, garage sales and estate sales. I called the cab company. They always use the same driver, too." Nancy gave me a rare smile. "The stories he could tell, huh?" "His name is Eddie French." She scribbled it on her desk pad. "City cab or yellow?" "Yellow." "Well, it sounds like a great idea, Maddy. Thanks." I went back to my desk, figuring that would be the end of it. I got busy marking up the Saturday and Sunday papers. That's my job. I've been the head librarian of the Herald Union for the past 34 years. In the newspaper business, we call the library the morgue. It's where we keep stories that have already run. The dead stories, if you will, in case reporters need them for background on the new ones they're writing. In the old days, I'd clip the stories with my big black-handled scissors, scribble a date on them, and cram them into those wonderful old battleship gray filing cabinets that used to grace the morgue. Now I go through the paper with a felt-tip pen, deciding which electronic files to store them in. This new system cost the paper a bazillion dollars and took years to implement. And, of course, the stories are no easier to find in cyberspace than they were in those old AZ filing cabinets. But you can't stop progress. I do try, of course. For one thing, I refuse to use my computer for anything more complicated than reading my email or ordering clothes from Chadwick's or Land's End. I leave all the real computer work to my assistant, Eric Chen. Keyboard-wise, he's a genius. Life-wise, he's a Class A doofus. Another thing I refuse to do is retire. I know I'm a royal pain in the ass around here, but there's no way in hell the morgue could function without me. And there's no way I could function without the morgue. So I stay on, one birthday cake shy of 70, making everyone's life just as miserable as I can. Anyway, I finished marking up the weekend papers and then walked down to Ike's coffee shop for lunch. I spent my usual 2 hours there at my little table by the window, stuffing myself with tuna salad and potato chips, yakking with Ike about this and that. On my way back to the paper, I stopped at the bank and renewed a couple of CDs, locking in that astronomical 2.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.